be seated. Please take your Bibles and turn with me to the letter of the Apostle Paul to the church in Rome, Romans, and we will be in chapter 12. As you turn there, I bring you greetings from your brothers and sisters at First Scots Presbyterian Church in Beaufort, and I'd also like to assure you of our prayers for you and your congregation at this time. Our text this morning is chapter 12, verse 1. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Listen to this. This is the very word of God. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. That's the reading of God's word. Let's ask him to bless his word to us. Father in heaven, as we approach the scriptures, and as your word is proclaimed, we pray that your Holy Spirit would be powerfully at work in each of us and utilize the great power of your gospel to strengthen us in the faith and to draw people to yourself. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you can think of someone that you've known or know whose whole life seems to revolve around or be focused on one particular activity or interest, sometimes you may have heard this expression used: he eats, drinks, sleeps, and breathes, and then fill in the blank, whatever that thing is. And those of you who have children, perhaps at some stage in the lives of your children, they took an interest in some activity, some musical pursuit, or a sport that they liked to play. It seemed like every moment of every day, they were thinking about it, talking about it. When they weren't doing it, they were thinking about the next time they had opportunity or would have opportunity to be involved in doing whatever this thing is. He or she eats, drinks, sleeps, breathes, soccer, piano, politics, whatever the case may be. We're called, each of us who are in Christ, in a sense, to have that perspective, to have that disposition of mind and heart and life towards Christ. And that's what this verse really is all about. The verse has the word therefore in it. I appeal to you, therefore. And the antecedent of that therefore is everything that has preceded in the book of Romans. And if you want a sort of quick and simple outline for the book of Romans, I like to call chapter 12, verse 1, the continental divide in the book of Romans, because this is where the focus shifts. In Romans, as with a number of Paul's letters, the opening chapters are very heavily doctrinal. He's teaching the truths of the Christian faith. And then at some point, he shifts his emphasis, and that on the basis of all the truth that has been proclaimed, he then begins to tell you and me how to live on the basis of the truths that he has taught and declared. And we've reached that point in Romans when we come to chapter 12, verse 1. Chapters 1 through 11 culminated with that great doxology in verse 36, for from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. chapter 12, and going on from verse 1, the emphasis is on specific application to the Christian life and answers the question, how should I live? I have believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. I am trusting in Him for salvation. I've committed my life to Him. What do I do now? What's next? How can I live so as to please God? And we begin to find out in this verse. We find out that gospel mercy obligates Christians to dedicate their lives to God as a total act of worship. That's what this verse in particular teaches us. Gospel mercy, which we have received in Christ, obligates Christians to dedicate their lives to God as a total act of worship. If you like to take notes and if you like to have the outline, here's my outline. First, we're going to see that God's mercy places every Christian under solemn obligation. That's the first point. Secondly, Christian faith requires total consecration to God. I'll repeat these for you later. And then thirdly, the whole Christian life is an act of worship. So in the first place then, God's mercy places every Christian under a solemn obligation. Every human being, as a matter of fact, is required. Every human being on planet Earth today and that has ever lived is obligated to serve and worship God. Have you ever thought about that? Because there are great many multitudes who are not serving Him, not worshiping Him, not living for Him, but they're under obligation to do it. Acts 17:30. He commands all people everywhere to repent. Have you thought about repentance as not just an invitation, but a command from God? He requires it. He commands it. All people everywhere to repent. Psalm 22, verse 28, declares that the Lord rules over Israel. No, not just Israel. He rules over the nations. He is the Lord of hosts. Psalm 117, verse 1 says, praise the Lord, all nations. Extol Him, all peoples. So just on the basis of creation, simply because of the fact that God made us and made us in His image, all people owe God worship. They are obligated to serve Him. But then those of us who have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ are doubly obligated. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies. This is the covenantal model. This is how salvation by grace through faith works. This is what we teach in the Reformed faith. The Lord saves, therefore we serve. We see this in the life of Abraham. God called Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldees. He told him to go to the land that He was going to show him. God entered into covenant with Abraham unilaterally. He took the initiative. And then He said to Abraham, walk before Me. Notice He didn't say to Abraham, walk before Me, and depending on how you do, maybe I'll make a covenant. He called Abraham to Himself. He initiated. He entered into covenant with Abraham. Then He said, walk before Me. And it's the same with all of the Old Testament saints. Every last one. First, God blesses. Then they obey. Like a pastor friend of ours always used to say, blessing precedes obedience. And that's the covenant model. And that carries over, of course, into the New Testament. Even more so than in the ministry of Jesus. John 15, verse 16, Jesus says to His disciples, you didn't choose Me, I chose you. Why? Because I appointed you that you should go and bear fruit. But His initiative, His choosing of them came first. Exodus is a model for us in this sense. It's a picture of what salvation is all about. And yes, Exodus is history. Those things truly happened. It's not fiction. It's not mythology. God really did bring this people out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. But it's also a picture for us. This true history of redemption teaches us. And so God brought Israel out of Egypt. He delivered or saved, we could say, his people so that they may worship him. Isn't that what he kept saying to Pharaoh? Let my people go that they may serve me, that they may worship me, that they may hold a feast to me in the wilderness. So we have these covenant verses, and on that basis, Paul is appealing to his hearers and his readers. He says, I appeal to you. That's what the ESV says in verse 1 of chapter 12. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers. It's a heartfelt plea. It's an affectionate, earnest plea to them. That word, if you happen to be using a different version of the English Bible than the ESV, you might have a word like, I urge you. It's a very strong word. It could even be translated beg. I beg you, brothers, by the mercies of God. So it's warm, it's heartfelt, but it's also relational. How does Paul address them? This apostle to the Gentiles, he calls them brothers. So this is not just a directive coming down from on high. He's not speaking to them as a superior to inferiors. He's addressing them as brothers. So this exhortation, then, because of the urgency of it, because of the warmth and the relational nature of it, it's of paramount importance. It must be done. And the basis of the appeal is the mercies of God. God's mercy had been a central theme, especially in the three chapters that precede this, where Paul teaches about God's mercy and the sovereignty of his mercy. So all of Romans up to this point is about gospel and the mercy found in it. And so therefore there's a suitable and appropriate and reasonable response to God's redemptive mercies. There is a so what to the mercies of God. And that's what's being commended to us in this verse. Salvation is a free gift. There's nothing we can do to earn it. There's nothing we can do even to deserve it. It's a free gift of God's grace, but it places an obligation on the redeemed. We are debtors, he said back in Romans 8, verse 12. Debtors. We owe. We owe everything. Therefore, point number two, Christian faith requires total consecration. Christian faith requires total consecration to God. He says, present your bodies, which is a way of saying, consecrate your whole being. Everything you do and say. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, Paul said, so, whether you eat, whether you drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. That got me wondering if that expression that we use, you know, he eats, drinks, sleeps, breathes, maybe it's ultimately rooted in Scripture. Think about the Shema in Deuteronomy. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. And he goes on to command his people to speak with their children about the words of God. When? When you lie down and when you rise up. When you sit in your house and when you walk in the bed, all of life, eat, drink, sleep, breathe, Christ. And so the use of this expression, bodies, present your bodies as a living sacrifice. It entails our lifestyle, our activities, our physical actions, what we do. And I think that exhortation probably came as quite a shock to some of the original readers and hearers of Paul's letter to the Romans. Because they lived in this culture that that was steeped in Greek thought. And you know what the Greeks thought about the body, don't you? They thought the body was something that was sub... It had less worth than the soul. It was dirty. It was... they had a very low view of the physical body. They thought the inner person, the soul, the spirit, that was the important part. And the body was just something that you hope eventually to get free of. That's how they viewed the body. When Paul's saying God wants your body, and he wants you to consecrate it to him, that probably shocked some people. What? This flesh? Yes. And the gospel was a correction in that sense. It was a correction to the wrong thinking, the wrong teaching of Greek culture and thought. Because God made man body and spirit. That's how he created him. God made man a physical being, and he breathed his spirit into Adam, and he became a living soul. Body, spirit. Both are fallen. Both body and soul are under a curse because of sin. And Christ died to save both. He didn't die just to save your soul. He died to save your body as well. And what proof do we have of that? We have the resurrection. The Lord God raised Jesus up from the dead, and he will raise you also on the last day. So we are to present our bodies as a sacrifice, something totally given up to God. The very idea of sacrifice carries the concept of a total commitment, a total consecration. If you took a sacrifice to the temple in Jerusalem, once that animal was slain and put on the altar, you can't take it back. It couldn't be a partial offering. It couldn't be halfway. There was nothing temporary about it. And that's how we're to view our lives in total as an offering to God. Now, the odd thing about this verse that might have sounded rather strange, again, to the original hearers, perhaps even to hearers today, is that he says, offer your bodies, present your bodies a living sacrifice, not for slaughter, but for service. Service to do whatever King Jesus requires. To serve in whatever role he assigns. Present your bodies a living sacrifice for service, to give whatever the Lord demands, to go wherever the Lord directs. To live for him or die for him as he appoints, as he sees fit. And in all of these respects and more, your offering is holy and it's acceptable to God. That word holy has several aspects of meaning. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, in the sense of being set apart. Being set apart for God, given up to him. In that sense, holiness is a status. It's a positional thing, we could say. To illustrate the idea of that positional holiness, sometimes I'll bring up the illustration of your nice china. You know, on Saturday at lunchtime, maybe you're having sandwiches for lunch. It's a simple meal, nothing all that special about it. You don't pull out the fine china. You might eat off of paper plates or just the regular dishes in the cabinet. But at Thanksgiving, maybe for Christmas dinner, then you pull out the really nice china that maybe was in your family for generations. Because that particular set of beautiful, valuable dishes, you save those for special occasions. That's a little bit like what being consecrated to God is. You're set aside. You're set apart for something special. Not that your service is infrequent like on holidays, but in the sense that you are better, you're different than just the ordinary dishes. You're special. That's part of what it means to be holy. You're set apart in God's eyes. There's also the idea, though, of godliness. That first aspect of holiness we sometimes call positional holiness. The second one we call progressive holiness, progressive sanctification. So you are a holy sacrifice also in the sense that you live as becomes the followers of Christ. Now, I don't know how many of you in here today are actually members of Church Creek PCA, but if you are members of this church, or if you've ever joined any PCA church, you took vows. And one of those vows is that you promised that in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit, you would endeavor to live as becomes the followers of Christ. That's being holy. That's being a holy sacrifice. And these kind of offerings are acceptable to God. And in and through the Lord Jesus Christ, they truly do please Him. Take some time once in a while to reflect on that. Because you know you fall short. We all do. We all mess up. Take some time once in a while to reflect on the fact that because of Christ, because of His merit, He is pleased with your acceptable sacrifice. Our obligation, our debt, as Paul put it elsewhere, is to live all of life for God's glory. Not in order to be saved, but because we are saved. Christian faith requires no less than this. Live your whole life for His glory. There aren't any rooms where Christ isn't allowed in your life. There's not any time on your schedule where He can't interfere. He wants it all. You owe all of it to Him. And that brings us to our third point. The whole Christian life is an act of worship. In Romans chapter 5, the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, His whole life, those 33 some odd years of perfect obedience to